a very short presentation, which may get into 20 or 25 minutes. It's similar to the one that has happened in the last 2 weeks, but based on some of the questions and comments, it's evolved over time. If you have questions and comments after, say, the first half hour, that's where Alan will start asking you. If you just say your name and your address, because we are going to now be taking minutes for this meeting formally. And if you could, we have a microphone somewhere around here for you. You can try without it. If we can hear you, that's fine. But just because they came to you and they raise their hand, you can use the microphone. Just to give you an idea of the calendar, after tonight, for the rest of June, questions? I'll have to do this. Is this okay?
Yeah.
For the rest of June and through early August, the various boards, particularly the trustees of the library, the selectmen, and the school committee, will be having different discussions. So, for instance, in the last several selectmen's meetings, there's typically been a half hour or an hour agenda item on there called something about financial situation. There doesn't happen to be one next week. So there will be these informal gatherings. We discussed at the last meeting the need for probably one or two more public meetings, which we haven't yet figured out when or what to say or what to do. So we'll skip those for now, but the next important date clearly is August 16th, Tuesday, at a Board of Selectmen meeting. That is their deadline to call for a special election and an override vote. Well, for a special election. If they do call for a special election and a town meeting, on Thursday, September 1st, a little different than what was in the paper today, there'll be a financial forum for the whole community at the High School Performing Arts Center. That's a really important night because that's the night you will first see in public what is being proposed by all the boards and committees for a solution. A week and a half later, on September 12th, there'll be a special town meeting. That night, an override will be voted on. If there are other warrant articles, it's possible it'll go to a second night of town meeting on that Thursday. The reason it needs to be voted that night is by the next day, on September 13th, the selectmen must formally tell the town clerk there's going to be a special election on October 18th. And that's in order to meet all the notification deadlines, particularly for overseas voters. So I'm going to go back 13 years from the last override, give you a little bit of history. And what I've learned over the last two meetings is I need to go a little slower, because that'll answer some of the questions that come. Over the last 13 years, you can see from the bottom that revenues have grown just a little more than 3% for Reading. The biggest growth has actually been property taxes, growing at a little over 3.5%. Just to explain that, we have something in Massachusetts called Prop 2.5, so that all the existing property tax lots and bills can only go up 2.5% each year. The reason it got up past 3.5% is, on average, over those 13 years, we've had 1% new growth. So if you change your house, you put on an addition, that's a very small amount of new growth. If someone knocks a house down and builds a new house, that's a bigger amount of new growth. Much more significantly, if a vacant lot turns into either a house or a business, that's a lot of new growth. So when we did the landfill, that was over $1 million of new growth, as an example. So on average, 1% new growth. And lately, that number has definitely declined. We'll talk a little about that. State aid has grown at a little more than 2.5%, which doesn't sound too bad, but there's a couple of years in there where state aid was 8 or 9%, and it was playing catch-up to some big cuts in prior years. So I'll come back to that. And then you can see the last two categories of revenue have really been growing very slowly. So 3% growth for the last 13 years since the last override. For the next 3 years, there's two sets of forecasts. If we start on the right-hand side, not using any cash reserves, we're looking at revenue growth of closer to 2%, just a little higher. If we're able to use cash reserves, which has become a recent trend, we might get as high as 2.5% revenue. So you can see right away there's a difference. And as I said, some of the growth is slowing, such as new growth and state aid, certainly. Spending has obviously had to match that. So we've spent just a little more than 3% for the last 13 years. Schools in the town, just about the same as the total. The reason that this has all worked is because we've been able to reduce our debt spending, especially, and to some degree capital, in order to pay for things that are largely out of our control, which I call shared benefits. That's things like pension, the health insurance, the OPEB, which is post-retirement health insurance, and a couple of other smaller items. And just to sort of talk a little about that 5.2% number, the health insurance premiums paid are just over 5% at a time when national trends are close to 8%. So 5% is terrible compared to our 3% revenue. Sadly, it's good compared to what's going on in the rest of the country. Our retirees and our employees have taken on, if you will, more than a typical share of the cost of these in order to save jobs, quite frankly. So our premiums paid result are comparatively good, but not sustainable against 3% revenues. And obviously, this is a national problem. For the next 3 years, what does it look like? Again, if we look on the right-hand side, we don't use any cash reserves, and I'm going to get into that later to explain what that is. We're forecasting the numbers below 3.9 and 7%, which only allows the schools in the town to need to make modest actual reductions to current budgets. And if the cash reserves are available to be used, 0.7%, which is a relatively small increase. And I want to talk a little about our savings account, what's usually consists of free cash. It's always a bad name, it's not free. This is the level of free cash over the last many years, and you can see the green dot is when we last had an override. So we were pretty close to tapped out free cash. We were down under $1 million at one point. You can see we've been building that over several years, over many years, and we've been very careful in saving money and spending money. I'll certainly come back to that. But in recent years, and the last one is a projection, but recent years, that number has started to decline. And at this point, it's really important that I say as much as I can, which is we still are involved with ongoing litigation on Reading Memorial High School. It's gone on for 10 years. It's been very painful, just from a time standpoint. We found out within the last month or so that the remaining construction funds will not be enough to settle the lawsuit. So for the first time, we know now that it's going to have to use some free cash and or debt financing in order to settle. And as soon as we settle, it will certainly let people know. Now I want to look outside of Reading into something that we call our peer communities. We had two different consultants over the last 7 years do statistical work with all the municipalities and the towns and the cities. And one thing they chose right away was to eliminate cities because of form of government, because they're just too different. So the remaining towns were looked at, and these 25 in blue are called our peer communities. You can see that many of them are geographically similar, but some are not. Against our peer communities, we're going to look at revenues and expenses. First, if you look at revenues, generally our peer communities collect a lot more in taxes as a percent of all their revenue than Reading does. We each collect about the same amount from the residential tax base, $54 million. Where the real difference is, on average, our peer communities have a lot more commercial, industrial, and personal property, or CIP. So on average, they're collecting $12 million a year from that class that we don't have in Reading. As a result of our property tax reliance being low, we tend to rely more on state aid and more on the other categories, especially local receipts. Local receipts in Reading is affected quite a bit by a $2.5 million, roughly, annual dividend from the light department. I mentioned that Reading is a little more reliant on state aid, and again, we will get into that. This is looking at it from the state's perspective, and I couldn't find 13 years, I had to find 15 years. The state has spent, and this is adjusted for inflation, in real terms, the state has spent 10% more over this period of time. Everything is negative, everything is lower except their contribution to healthcare. Doesn't that tell a story? So of this money the state spends, their real increase in healthcare has been 64%. Everything else is not being funded as well as it used to be. And oh, by the way, local aid is worse. So that's been cut in half. So we have not been able to rely on state aid, and there doesn't seem to be any immediate reason why that's going to change. This is an interesting chart, looking at the 25 communities, and Reading is in there somewhere. And it looks at median family income against single-family home property taxes. There's an acknowledged correlation between those two. And you can see from the slope or the regression line that's true. For those of you that haven't been to the first couple meetings, I'll ask a general question. Raise your hand if you think Reading is above this line. And raise your hand if you think Reading is below this line. Interestingly, a lot of people I talk to on the street, I can't go anywhere, all said above. Taxes in Reading are very high. They're certainly above average. No, they're not. You know, high and low is a subjective case, but compared to the peers, Reading's taxes are low. And this includes the high school debt, and it includes most of the library debt. Some of that is being sold next week. If you look at just a pure mathematical average of these 25 communities, those are the numbers down below. Reading is $500 low. If you look at the regression that was produced there, Reading is $700 below the median. So that, what that tells you is, in general, you're receiving services from the community in a cost-effective way. We are not spending as much as some of our neighbors. Now, some of the dots you can see are quite significantly high on that chart. But the one that's just above to the left is, for instance, North Reading. And a lot of that is driven by their high school, middle school, certainly. But it's interesting to see that in terms of property taxes against our peers, Reading is doing pretty well. Now, how do we spend money versus our peers? And the answer is, in that far right-hand column, we spend it almost identically like our peers. There's not big differences. And it's interesting, I looked at some of our contiguous neighbors. None of them are as boring as Reading in terms of how they spend money. They all choose one thing or another to emphasize or de-emphasize. For instance, you'll see shortly Stoneham spends far less on education because they don't have as many students. We spend a little more on public safety. We spend a little more on general government, which is town hall. But really, none of these numbers jump out as being significant. So if none of them are significant, how can we be so low on per pupil? As I just showed you, education was slightly above average as a percent of our spending. If you look at this chart, Reading, on average, has 15%, 15.8% of the population is enrolled in the public school system. I'm sorry, Reading is 17.4. The peer average is 15.8. You can see the high is Westford at 22%, and there's that Stoneham figure I mentioned at 10.7%. It's acknowledged that running the school is the more expensive part of running a town. The more students you have, the more that your revenues must be directed at schools. There are state aid available to help compensate some of that cost, but state aid absolutely does not pay for the amount of students you have in a community. So it's both true that we're spending a tiny bit above average as a percent of the budget on schools, but below average per pupil. We have a lot of students. Some of the conclusions we can draw from some of the things I've just said will come as no surprise. Reading's a bedroom community. We have a low commercial tax base. We have residential property taxes that are below our peer averages. We have a large student population to educate. The town, anecdotally, wants a high quantity and quality of services from both the town and the schools. For the foreseeable future, our revenues do not look like they will grow at 3%, which is what we've managed to live on since the last Prop 2.5 override. We are planning on and working on some economic development efforts, but any of you that drive around town know there's not a lot of vacant land to be developed, so it's being worked on somewhat creatively. And whatever the economic development solution is going to take quite a while. It's not going to get us out of any problems we may have, but it'll help. We mentioned earlier that town and school budgets will either increase at just under a percent or decrease slightly, depending on whether or not we can use those cash reserves, and that it is contingent upon the litigation. In either case, the town and the schools will need to reduce staffing, and both Dr. Doherty and I will show you that shortly. an operating override, which is a permanent increase in taxes. So right now we have two debt exclusions, the library and the high school. In 8 more years, those projects will be fully paid off. So in 8 more years, your taxes will go down if nothing else changes. That's a temporary tax. An operating override is a permanent tax. So an operating override fixes a permanent mismatch in your revenues and income, which is, expenses, which is what we have. But the selectmen as a group have a lot of concerns about an override. One is what seems to be an increasing gap in expectations of the community. There is a fair amount of people who have lived in the community a long time and are perfectly happy with the way it is. There are some people in the community, and many seem to have moved in recent years, who expect a lot more. We keep trying to tell them that the reason they came to Reading instead of Lexington was not only because the house was cheaper, the taxes were also lower. They can't have all the things Lexington offered. They don't always like that. It's clear that elderly residents' ability to pay is a really high concern of the board. Thanks, John. And maintaining a quality of services and the quantity of services is really important to the community. That's one of the things I'm going to ask you shortly is about services you use and whether we can cut them or not. And clearly, we haven't come to the voters for 13 years for an override. I don't know that, you know, at the time it was planned 8 to 10 years. We'll probably want to plan another 8 to 10 year override. But as you'll see shortly, it's not something Reading asks often. I do want to spend a little bit of time on the elderly residents' ability to pay. The board and many in the town want to help our seniors age in place. We don't want to force them out of their homes for financial reasons. This issue is becoming a challenge in our region where housing is very expensive. And it's becoming a contentious one in some of the towns. We've already done some things to help at the margin. Our zoning laws have started to change over the last 2 years. So for instance, we have in-law apartments by right. Very, very few communities have that yet. The state senate is now looking at zoning and they've passed something that allows this by right, and I happened to be talking to our state senator last weekend, and he wasn't aware that Reading had already done it. He said, wow, you're way ahead of the curve. And the reason we're ahead of the curve is for this issue, elderly residents' ability to pay. At a future town meeting, these three articles will come, regardless of whether there is or is not an override requested. They're all relatively small impact. They are all examples of the town giving up a small amount of revenue, but these things, you know, will affect somewhere between 20 and 40 residents, and they're the most vulnerable 20 to 40 residents. Again, it's small money, but potentially it could mean quite a lot to them. The third one is an interesting one that we will have to probably do a better marketing job of. It's, on the one hand, somewhat appalling that we have to do this, but on the other, it could be quite attractive. If you qualify as an elderly with a low income, you can defer all the property taxes on your home. You don't have to pay out anything. Right now, the interest rate on that is 8%. We'd like to lower that to 4%. I think that's the lowest we're allowed to lower it to. However, if you die when you're in that situation, it retroactively goes back to the state law penalty of 16% a year. And I've talked to a couple folks who are in this situation. They said, what do I care? That'll be my heirs' problem. So that's one possibility. You see at the bottom a couple of possible things we might add that, again, will help at the margin. But this is the big one. This is something that only a handful of communities have done in Massachusetts. But more and more, such as Reading, are looking at. And I'll tell you right now, the state DOR does not like this one bit. But we can pass home rule petition, and again, some communities have done it, to shift taxes from one set of taxpayers to another. So for instance, we could pick a dollar number, let's call it $1 million, and we could shift $1 million away from those that qualify for the state's tax circuit breaker, which is about 650 households in Reading out of 9,000. It's not insignificant. And depending how much, where you qualify, if you barely qualify, you'll get a very small tax break. If you qualify by quite a lot, you could get quite a significant tax break. But someone else is going to pay. It'll be redistributed to all the people who don't qualify. So Sudbury has a framework like this. We've met with all three of our legislators now, and they do caution us about the state not liking these sorts of things, but I'm confident they can sneak it right past. Over the next 6 weeks, the selectmen will be discussing this with the Board of Assessors. We've done a lot of work at the staff level, and we're ready to go public. It's either July 12th or July 26th. The net result of this, and I'll really have to run some numbers, are there probably will be some seniors that not only don't pay any override, their taxes go down from where they are today, just as an example. I'm going to spend a little bit of time on this slide, because it has a lot of interesting messages, at least to me. These are all our 25 peer communities, and it's sorted by that category that says RES percent. So Milton, 96% is residential. Reading is 91% residential. And Burlington is the opposite end of the spectrum, just barely 62% residential. So that's the way they're sorted. The most left-hand column next to the town's name, total, that's how many times these communities have brought forth Prop 2.5 overrides since it began. And you can see Reading is very low, not quite as low as Linfield or Walpole, but only asking 5 times. It's relatively low. I'm not saying that's good or bad, it's just a fact. But it's also interesting, as we keep looking at these, that there seems to be two sets of towns, the right and the left-hand side, conveniently. All of the towns on the left-hand side with higher residential tax burdens as a percent have asked for an override since Reading last asked. A couple of other towns on the right-hand side have also asked. 3 of them got a no, 2 of them got a yes. Almost all the communities on the left-hand side have passed an override since Reading did. Only Stoneham is not. They asked, but they said they were told no. Tax rate information has come up in the last two sessions in terms of the split between commercial and residential. We'll probably get into that in the question and answer section, but what you can see from this chart is communities such as Reading that do not split the tax rate, in other words, charge businesses more of an amount, tend to be those that are residential because there's not much of a commercial tax base to tax. But if you look over on the right-hand side and look at some of those splits, Bedford, Canton, Wilmington, and Burlington, all above 2, what that says is that their commercial taxpayers are paying substantially more than the residential taxpayers, but there's already a big commercial industrial presence in those communities, so it matters. The superintendent and I are now going to talk a little about what we've done. I got an interesting quote today from Standard & Poor's. We're, again, selling debt next week. If any of you are interested, call your local banks. Actually, Reading Co-op might be interested. They said, quote, "We believe the town can maintain better credit characteristics than the U.S. federal government in a stress scenario," unquote. We're rated AAA. The federal government is rated AA. I think that's interesting. This is my background is in this field. I never thought this would ever happen because the federal government can print money, and so far as I know, we can't.
Excuse me for a second, but I'd just like to call the Board of Selectmen to order.
Oh, yeah. We'll pretend that happened a while ago.
Didn't see Barry.
So we have conservative financial practices that are clearly now well recognized. We've also spent money to save money. The superintendent, for instance, has spent a little extra money on in-district special education in order to avoid outplacements. We've done a lot of energy improvements. Our capital equipment and our capital plan has been good, and much of it has actually been aimed at reducing operating costs. We used to have a really high maintenance budget and repair budget in DPW, for instance. And we both built really fairly modern technology infrastructure, which has helped us all be more efficient. The town and the schools share personnel and software internally, and we also regionalize or have regionalized outside the town to share things with other communities. You're most familiar with the term mutual aid in the fire department, and there's both informal and formal sharing arrangements in virtually all of our departments at this point. When we have had an excess of cash reserves, you saw our savings account was pretty good. We've been really disciplined about spending what we view as one-time money on one-time expenses. So any town meeting members that have been here a while know that in November, when we close out the year and we happen to have a good year, we tend to spend some money on capital in November because it's one-time money and it's a one-time expense. And lastly, questions have come up in other meetings. where did this all come from? I never heard of it. Why are you telling me now? Again, anyone in town meeting has heard this speech for a very long time. I'll introduce now Dr. Doherty.
Thank you. Thank you for coming this evening. Next several slides, both the school department and town are going to present to you the impact of what Bob's been talking about. So the first I want to do is I want to show you what's happened over the last two fiscal years and looking forward to FY17, which was passed at town meeting in early May. So you can see that over the last 3 years, we have had to make level service budget reductions each year. So we define level service as doing the same things that we've done the previous year, but moving them forward with the anticipated expenses that go along with it. So you can see in FY15, we had to make a reduction of $285,000. And you see the breakdown between personnel and non-personnel and what are called offset and grant increases to try to minimize the personnel reductions. In FY15 and this year, we were able, which is FY16, we tried very hard to stay away from reductions in the classroom. Particularly FY16, where you see we had to make a cut of $849,000. And so our personnel reductions were minimal, and we made most of those reductions with non-personnel and increasing offsets and getting grants. But in FY17, we had to shift that a little bit. And so we are making some significant personnel reductions for next year that are $403,000. So what that looks like for next year is at the elementary level, we're cutting two classroom teachers, and they're going to be at Killam. So we're going to have higher class sizes in grades 3 and 5 at Killam next year. At the middle school, we had to reduce a 0.5 reading teacher, which equalizes the reading services across the district. At the high school, that's where most of the reductions were. We had to reduce 4.6 classroom teachers and one library paraeducator, which led to the elimination of all of our freshman advisory classes and reductions of course sections across all departments except the special education and guidance, because those class sizes and caseloads were already too high. It also had an impact on the high school library hours and what was available during the day and after school. So next year, we are already making the reductions because of that, the revenue that Bob has been referring to. So as we look into FY18, what does this look like? If we go with the 0.7, I'm a little bit more optimistic, a 0.7% increase instead of a minus 0.3%, the total increase on the budget would only be $284,000. So you can imagine what's going to happen is it's going to result in close to a $2 million budget shortfall. And this is a back-of-the-envelope projection. We're again assuming that it's a level service budget, and we're moving things forward with the assumptions of the cost increases that have been happening over the last 3 years. So how do you break this down? And one of the things that came up in previous listening sessions is, well, what could you do? Could you just make non-personnel reductions to make up the deficit of the $2 million in cuts? And as we've already shown in FY17 next year, unfortunately, we've already had to make reductions in the classroom. But when you take a look at the wages versus the expenses, schools by nature are heavy personnel. They're working with students. So our non-personnel expenses are much less than our personnel expenses. So when you look at the five cost centers, and you see the breakdown on the left-hand side, by cost center, those on the left-hand side, those are all the non-personnel or expenses that are not personnel related. So under the administration cost center, you can see what's in parentheses there. You have a legal budget. We have to do annual audits. Those are mandated. We have to do employee physicals, and you have some licensing. Under regular day, you have text and materials, textbook and materials, supplies, professional development, classroom technology. Special education, again, a lot of this would be required under the law for a student's individualized education plan. You have out-of-district tuition, out-of-district transportation, and then adaptive text and materials. And then school facilities, with the shift going to the town core, really the only remaining non-personnel expenses in this area would be the contracted cleaning services and cleaning supplies. And then the district-wide programs, which is a very small group, which is your health services, extracurricular athletics, and technology infrastructure. So you can see that there isn't a lot of non-personnel expenses. You couldn't cut $2 million out of this non-personnel group without making cuts or reductions in personnel expenses. So if we were going to look at a possible FY18 reduction and what that would look like, so if we could reduce, and again, this is all back of the envelope. We have not developed an FY18 budget. We're not even close to doing that yet. But if you were to reduce expenses by $300,000, which would be eliminating pretty much all of teacher professional development, technology purchases, reducing the supplies and materials that are purchased at each school to run the day-to-day operations, and any other miscellaneous expenses, if you could get $300,000 out of the expenses, that would still leave $1.6 million in wages and personnel expenses that we would have to make. And so what we're looking at, if you were going to do a straight, just looking at teachers and how many FTEs that would be, assuming that the reductions that we would be making for teachers that would be more on the lower end of the scale at about $50,000 to $55,000, you're talking close to 30 FTEs of teacher reductions. Now that won't happen because there will be a combination of teacher reductions, support staff reduction, administrative reductions. So it won't be 30, but it would be a combination of that. But the impact of that, and we're already seeing the impact for next year, is that you would see higher class sizes at all levels. You would see elimination of different programs, and you would see reduced student support. So that's what the reduction would be if we had the $2 million using the revenue projections that Bob talked about earlier. So now I'm going to turn it back over to Bob, and he'll explain some of his slides.
Thank you, John. To look at it from the town side, it's pretty much the same story with some slightly different figures. I've added a category or a column here called not funded. Our department heads over the years have requested budgets that are not even close to what we can afford, but I've always encouraged them to request it because we need to know what's on the horizon and I need to know what they're thinking. Last year, for instance, the request came in $1.5 million above what we could fund, and I would characterize $660,000 of that as the level service that Dr. Doherty referred to, and $860,000 as new things that we weren't doing that they thought that the community should do. So for instance, if our human elder services wanted to add more social services, more counseling hours, that would be, by me, described as a new service. In FY17, we eliminated 6 part-time and 1 full-time position, so we're probably 1 year behind Dr. Doherty in terms of really needing to hit the personnel side. Looking ahead at FY18, as Dr. Doherty did, we do have more of expenses in our budget, and you'll quickly see that that's not easy to cut them, but we have 17 to 8 million as a ratio. If we have to cut almost $1 million, I'll get into that shortly, but if you look at those 8 million expenses, most of the things I put in parentheses are not things one can cut. So we have to pay insurance, we have to have legal protection, we have to have a certain amount of technology. By law, we must pay out veterans benefits and have a certain amount of health, public health. So far, we're collecting the rubbish for free. Some towns have a fee for that. Snow removal, street lights, and energy are all requirements. The maintenance number could be reduced slightly, but if you think back to 10 or 15 years ago and remember the condition of some of the schools, that's not necessarily a good course. So, as John gave an example, I can imagine us cutting a couple hundred thousand out of expenses without really damaging things like facilities. When faced with a real problem of wages versus expenses, maybe you do a little more expenses, and you know it's not ideal, but you hope for a better day. The town has an average wage across all personnel of about $50,000, so that's almost 14 full-time jobs. We have some choices in the first three to reduce what I would call depth and hours: public safety, both police and fire, public works, and library. have many positions that have several people in them. So in the case of library, we could reduce library hours. And the other two tend to like to work 24 hours a day. We can't do that, I don't think. But there would be less depth in the police and fire positions. At Town Hall, we really don't have a lot of repetition or depth. At Town Hall, when we start to do cuts, we will have to eliminate very specific services that the community has said they wanted. So at that point, I want to make a couple comments and then turn it over to our moderator. Just to be very clear, myself as town manager, and I can speak for the Board of Selectmen, I'm neither for nor against an override. What we are for is making sure the community gets the real information out there of what the truth is and understands. The last thing we want to hear is, if I had only known that, I might have voted yes. Now let the community vote for what it wants and we will provide the government that you want. Just to be really clear about that. But I do want to make sure that the community is not surprised. And if you've seen some of the numbers up here, you'll see we really are now in a situation where we can't wait anymore to ask. We really have to ask. Before I turn it over to Alan, I want to ask some questions that I want you to think about. And obviously you can comment on anything you want. For those of you that, in addition to wanting to fund what we do, what services don't we do that you'd like to see added? I can tell you that we get a lot of suggestions at Town Hall on this one. What services that we provide should be eliminated? And you're free to make any comment you want on that. However, it gets more difficult. What services do you use that you'd be willing to give up? And I can tell you now we're over 10 public forums. I have never once had a person stand up and answer that question honestly with something they use and they could do without it. I would hope someone can answer that one. Do you prefer to target fees instead of taxes? That's somewhat of a philosophical question because for those of you that itemize on your federal income tax, you won't be able to deduct the fees, whereas you can deduct the property tax. But there are communities, such as Stoneham, that has a trash fee. If we had a trash fee, that could be $1 million or more. It would reduce the need to make some of those eliminations, but you'd all be paying for the trash to be picked up. And lastly, and most importantly, people in our prior audiences came in with a lot of different levels of understanding of our financial situation, of our budget process, and so forth. Just generally, what are you concerned about as a Reading resident? At this point, I'll turn it over to Alan Fools, and I do want to emphasize that every and any question are good questions. Thank you.
Good evening. Welcome to the third listening session. This is your chance to be heard and to ask questions. And make sure you do. Don't sit back. If you've got something you want to ask, make sure you do it. We have town officials and senior staff here that hopefully will be able to answer anything you ask them. Now, we're going to run this something like town meeting, obviously a little less formally, no motions or anything like that. But I'm going to call on people roughly as I see the hands go up, trying to get first-timers first. Okay. Also, I ask that you not interrupt someone who has the microphone. You'll get your chance. And also, one last thing, state your name before you begin speaking so we know who we're talking to. All right, let's just get right into it. Questions? Yes, right in the back. Yes.
I'm Tom Grant, 15 Lowther Road. Trying to understand Proposition 2.5, it makes me think that town revenues should generally increase 2.5% per year. So I'm not sure why town revenues are forecast to fall at any point.
I'll repeat the question. Let me just go back to an earlier slide. I don't know, backwards from forwards. The question was, given Prop 2.5, how can revenues ever go below 2.5? Which is certainly a fair question. If you look at this chart, this is the best example. In the past, we've seen 3.6% increases in taxes, so it's that 2.5 plus some new growth. We're forecasting just below 3% because we do not forecast that new growth. For instance, we don't have a landfill to develop. So there's a reduction right there. The others are not, as a group, not that far off. Property taxes are the biggest single part. Remember that other slide, it was 60% of our revenue. So new growth is the biggest reason why we're going below 3% to 2.6. But you can see again that there were three other major components worth 40% of our revenues that are not growing at 2.5%. They have not grown historically at 2.5, and they are not projected to grow at 2.5. There's those three categories below. So, you know, if we were running a business, it's nice to have 60% of your revenues guaranteed to go up 2.5% a year or more. On the other hand, it's very hard to have your revenues go up much more than that. We can't, you know, create a new product or raise our prices.
Next. Yes, what are we here? Okay.
Jeffrey Corn, Ridge Road. I wondered if you could talk a little bit from the people here about the drivers of the increases in expenses. So we said the level service budget would increase much more than the 0.7%. I certainly understand that health insurance is a big chunk of that, but I would say, you know, that because wages are such a big piece of it, we also have a story nationwide that salaries are not increasing, that there isn't much inflation, and that we don't see a lot of cost of living adjustments. So I wonder, what is it that's driving those salaries to increase in town schools?
Thanks, I'll start, and then I'll turn it over to John. I'll speak first of the town side. The comment that's come up at prior meetings are, generally speaking, we expect top quartile service out of our employees, but we are only going to pay them an average wage. Philosophically, that's not an easy thing to accomplish, but that's the philosophy of the town side of government. Right now, we are paying 7% below average against our peer communities for town employees, but we're still demanding top quartile performance. So wages are growing, albeit slowly, and we've not been keeping up. But wages have grown somewhere around 2.5% for these 13 years. And that's, again, with more or less flat staffing on the town side. So you could argue that in some parts of the private sector, wage growth of 2.5% over that period of time is high. I can also tell you in a lot of parts of the private sector, 2.5% is very low. So there's no real answer to that. But our objective is not to compare to the private sector. It's to compare to our peers, because frankly, that's the competition for our staff. And it is becoming more difficult to hire people and retain people because we are paying below average wages and we're not asking them to read the newspaper and sleep all day. We're actually asking for top quartile performance.
Very similar story on the school side. Out of all the comparable communities, and we use similar comparables that town uses. We are in the bottom half when in terms of wages compared to the comparable communities. It's becoming more and more difficult to fill some of the high difficult positions, special education, science, mathematics, foreign language. We are having staff that are leaving to go to other districts where they are making $7,000 to $10,000 more a year in salary. So it is becoming more and more difficult to hire staff and get those quality staff and to also retain those quality staff. Any other questions? Yes, up on the aisle, yes.
See from this chart again, we're more like the communities on the left-hand side. And about half of them are doing the same thing we are, and about half of them are not. Wakefield's is kind of an interesting example right next door. They're on the top of the right-hand side. They are charging double the tax rate of residential for commercial. To some degree, this is a philosophical question for the Board of Selectmen, but historically, it's also been a practical question. We have such a small amount of commercial that in order to split the rate, I'll just use examples, and I know these numbers aren't right, so don't worry, I'm just making them up completely. But if the average home saved $100 because of a shift in taxes, the average business would go up $2,000. And that disproportion is believed by many of the boards historically to be those businesses that have to pay those property taxes are just gonna pass along the cost to the consumer, which are often Reading residents. Do you think they'll have to pay more than $100 that they saved in costs? If you shop in town a lot, you will. So it's a philosophical question. And just to be clear, the communities that tax businesses more are not producing more revenue. It's just who pays. So Wakefield has the same Prop 2.5 that we do. Their businesses just pay a larger proportional share, if you will, of taxes than they do in Reading.
Hey, right up here. I'm sorry.
I'm Colleen O'Shaughnessy, Walnut Street. I think there may be 250, 300 new condos down on 128, and maybe they pay $2,000 to $3,000 each property taxes, at least. I don't understand why that chunk of money isn't improving the budget.
Bob?
Thank you. It did. That was part of new growth 1 year. Actually, it's part of new growth over several years. So we had $900,000 of new growth the year we're currently in, which ends in a couple weeks. Our historical average is $500,000. Some of that is Pulte Homes, exactly as you suggest. Some of it is Johnson Woods. So there have been developments that have added to that. And in the last couple of years, say 3 or 4 years, our new growth average is above $500,000. Whereas it's a historic average. Looking forward, we don't have any projects in the pipeline like that, so we can't rely on, Johnson Woods is not yet finished, Pulte is not yet finished. Our assessors know how much value there is left. There's no other big project in town queued up to give us more new growth, but those absolutely have added some new growth.
But won't those individual homeowners be paying every year?
Yes. That increases that by new growth, that increases it for 1 year and then permanently. And that's reflected in all of this math that I've shown.
Yes, so we're moving.
Repeat the question. This is the elevated lead levels that have been found, especially at Kilimanjaro and a couple of other schools. We've worked with the schools through our water department on this. Most of the problems have been identified as very low cost items and will be done, and they are being done right now. Some of the issues might be a slight more long term, and by that I mean August instead of June. We don't really have our arms around it, but I'm quite sure that we will fix it. And it's all within the water budget. So if your water rates go up next year, this might be worth 2 cents on the rate. But the problem with lead in the water has nothing to do with your taxes, just to be clear. It is all a water enterprise fund issue. And again, so far, what we've identified, the problems health-wise may be somewhat significant. Financially, they are not significant to fix. Do you have anything on that, John?
No, pretty much what you said.
Yes, right here.
Sure. If you think of a typical home that's maybe a $500,000 home, it's a little bit old, it's on a certain piece of land, most of the value is the land, not the home. Someone buys it, knocks it down, and puts up a mansion of some sort. Now it's an $800,000 or $900,000 home. The new growth is what the difference was, so $300,000 or $400,000. That might be $3,000 or $4,000 in extra taxes. So that will feed into new growth. You'd have to have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of those in town to really notice. So yes, it is a significant part of new growth. It's a couple hundred thousand worth, but it's not going to make the number go from 500,000 to a million as the landfill did for a couple of years. I think it was over a 2-year period. So really, the communities that have more new growth than we do are developing vacant land, and usually they're developing it commercially or very large housing projects.
More questions? Yes, right up in the back.
How do we budget, basically, is the question between schools and towns. I was at a community meeting upstairs, and I commented there were 6 school committee members and only 5 selectmen, and they usually won best of 4. And that wasn't received very well. The truth is, for the last 10 years, we have a fairly regimented budget process. I'll do it as quickly as I can. There are certain costs called accommodated costs that we philosophically believe should be paid or need to be paid right off the top. So, for instance, snow and ice. By choice, out-of-district special education, and the list goes on. What's left is then available for the schools and the town to split in their operating budgets. Historically, that ratio is about 2-to-1. Recently, we made the facilities department move around a little, so it's not quite that ratio. But once you take all those fixed costs away, it's a traditional split. Now, in a given year, either the schools or the town, or both, may say, I have something new. So for instance, when we first added a school resource officer, we viewed that as being, although both sides agreed with it and wanted it and supported it, as a police officer, it was going to come out of the town's budget. So we proposed that to be thrown into the accommodated costs for just the first year, and effectively we split the cost two-thirds, one-third that way. So it's a fairly well-disciplined one. It's not a free-for-all. We don't fight all the time. But there are, you know, some spirited discussions sometimes about we're adding something new to the budget, where do we put it and who should pay for it? The default is if you're adding something, you're subtracting something.
And so another hand just on the other side of the aisle. Okay, right here.
Mike Fusco, Emerald Drive. What determines the amount of state aid you receive?
Who you voted for representatives. let me find that chart again. You know, this by and large, unfortunately, determines it. The state has certain revenues. Next year they're projecting like a 4.5% increase in revenues. Their allocation to health care, which is not employees' health insurance, it's all the other programs they offer for residents in the community. That eats up almost all their new money, and they have to continuously cut. So state aid is done first by the governor in January. He proposes a certain state aid figure for each community. Then either the House or the Senate, normally the House takes it up and they propose a figure, some years higher, some years lower, and then the Senate does it. And then they all get together, which is what they're doing right now, and they agree on some settlement. I just read this morning that state revenues suddenly are created a $750,000 or $1 million gap, wouldn't be thousand. I don't know where that came from, because last week it was fine, but anyways, the local aid that we're looking at next year is about a 1 to 1.5% increase. It may not be that much, but it's Beacon Hill that totally determines that. There are virtually no guarantees of any of the state aid coming to us, although in Reading's case and many other communities, there's a handshake on a certain minimum per student per community. I think the minimum is $25.
$25, yeah.
This year, the proposed budget is $55 per student, so it's above that. But that's the only thing that's guaranteed. The rest, you're on your own.
Thank you. Yes, Tom?
Yes, Thomas J. Ryan, Precinct 1, 87 Gate Road. 87 Daniel Road, excuse me. First of all, I don't care what other communities are spending. I'm concerned about what we spend here in Reading. And we're hearing about, I mean, if you want an override, move to Arlington. They have their one there about once a month. And the thing is, we're talking budget cuts. Cuts are made in the school budget, cuts in the town budget, and yet every single year, since Prop 2.5 came into effect in 1981, we are spending more and more every single year. In 1987, we had a levy limit of about $30 million. In 2003, the year of the override, the levy limit was roughly $44 million. 13 years later, we're up to $62 million. That's the levy limit. And this year, it's going to increase the next year, fiscal year, by 2.5%, whether you like it or not. And that would be roughly $1,500,000. And the way we spend it, two-third school, one-third town, that's about $1,033,000 more for the schools on top of the $62 million, and about $566,000 for the town side. And you're saying we need more money, and you want an override. You don't tell us how much it's going to cost. Like you just pointed out, the average assessed value regarding 2016 was $499,500. How much is that going to cost the family? I can't vote for something when you tell me what it's not going to cost. And if you're not interested in cost, I better use carbon, sell fuel. That's a good way.
As I said at the beginning, this is for information. Anyone can vote what they want. We're really just presenting facts. The one fact we don't have yet is how much, first of all, should the selectmen request an override? And if they do, how much? That's what the next 6 or 8 weeks are for. We're out listening to the community to get a sense of what the appetite is. I just got the sense of one of the appetites. But that's the whole point of this. We're not gonna top down, just impose a number and say this is the right answer. We're trying to listen. Based on what we hear, we'll all sit down. We'll come up with different scenarios and different possibilities. They'll be discussed in public meetings, and the community will be well informed well before it needs to make a choice. You know, the facts are, you're right, budgets go up every year, and as I showed you, they've been going up 3% a year on average for the last 13 years. Maybe that works, maybe that doesn't. The problem is, some of our costs are going up more than 3%, which leaves less than 3% for the schools in the town. And again, I'm neither for nor against an override, but I'll say that sometimes we get vendors from the country that are offering services and products to municipalities all over the country. And I've caught on to this, but at first I didn't. We were talking to a small town in Indiana that was doing some tremendous work in stormwater and GIS work. And the technology was light years ahead of where we were, and we thought we were pretty good. Finally, I asked the question, how much does your budget go up every year? Whatever we needed to. There's no Prop 2.5 there. They were going up 7 and 8% a year. So maybe Massachusetts is Taxachusetts at the state level, but at the local level, it is absolutely not. 2.5 is a very small increase relative to where things are today, especially with health insurance. If it had been Prop 3, I wouldn't need to be here.
Yes.
Right now, none.
So when it opens, and it's fully funded.
None. No increase in the budget other than a historic increase. I think it was 2.5-3%. I don't remember exactly. Now, after they run the place for a while, if there's money available, will they request more? I would expect so. But there was not an immediate need. It's much better sight lines than the old library, so each individual person can see the kids where they are, for instance. So there's not going to be a shock to the system. The library did conduct a study from a consultant down in Connecticut, and they suggested over the next 5 years, if you can afford it, you should add 3 positions to a library that's somewhere in the low 20s. So that's not a must-have. That's maybe one of them is a must-have, and two of them are nice-to-haves. So I don't expect a huge increase in the library budget. And again, just to remind everyone, quite honestly, you're going to see less hours if we have financial problems.
I saw a hand in the back. Yes.
Matt, when the doctor started speaking, there was a slide that showed we were 250 short in 2015 and 850 short in 2016. And then I think it was 650 back then. You know, what's going up or what is going down? It looks like, is that 200% increase? What's those numbers there? What is 285 to all of a sudden we're $600,000 short next year? Right? Am I reading that correctly?
So why is it gone up by so much?
To go even, level, you tell me the cost increase of the 650, we didn't generate $650,000?
These are the increases beyond, this is the reductions that we had to make from a level service budget. So if we were able to do a level service budget each year, so move all of our services, programs, everything that we do for our students forward to the next year with the increases that normally happen, these are the reductions that we have to make. We've not had a level service budget.
So from 2015, right, to go right to 2016 level, those exact services and everything else cost $600,000 more.
That is correct, because some expenses are going up higher than others.
So we took in the same amount of exact money the year prior to go level, it's $650,000 increase.
No. The level service budget each year is going up based on the same amount of services. So each year our level service budget is actually, we're not providing level services. So for the last 3 years, we've been providing below level service, and that is getting less and less because each year we're cutting more and more from what a level service budget should be.
Do we add 650 to the budget, or the cost of doing business status quo?
We do get an increase from and it's been about a 3.1% increase on average over the last 13 years. But expenses are going up higher. As Bob was saying.
We didn't add anything. We just cost $650,000 more due to the cost of business and revenue.
And they didn't get it.
And we didn't get it, so we had to make the reductions.
State your name.
Ed VanDeWall, 11 Geary Road.
Okay. Any question?
Question is, would you be able to let us open up the books so we can see on the account hand of it?
I'm not sure what you mean, so open up the floor.
I'm not sure what you're asking.
Did we know exactly where the money is going?
I'm not certain what your question is, so let me answer what you might have asked. If you're asking for budget information, there's more than you'd ever want on the website, and I can help you find that. Okay.
It was just on the new money that's coming up. I was just wondering exactly what was going on.
Okay. Yeah, if you go to the homepage of the town, I don't remember what it is. I hope you can find it. Google's a wonderful tool. And you look at a budget on the front page, you'll find all the more the information than anyone should ever want.
Thank you.
Same with the school department budget is on our district webpage. The other thing is, and I believe this is also the same for the town, our expenses get audited every single year. So we have, there's a full audit that is public information.
That's good.
Thank you. What are the questions?
Yeah. No. It's in litigation. I really can't say. What I will say is the construction fund is about $750,000 in it, and the settlement for the final settlement for the litigation will clearly be more than that. Beyond that, I really actually can't comment.
More questions? Yes.
Dave Maresco, Hancock Street. Just a question about
with the increase in revenue that would come with the override, specifically for the schools, would we see just that being keeping the teaching at status quo, or would we see an increase in positions back to perhaps where in previous years before prior custodian?
I think you should answer this piece, and then I can.
I'll end up with the schools. I don't get to do that often. That's one of the philosophical questions that's to be debated over the next 2 months on what's the appetite in the community for services up or down. There's choices. We can calculate, and you've seen roughly, that the schools need $2 million and the town needs $1 million to provide the same service next year, roughly. That's $3 million. If you want an override to last for a period of time, you have to have more money that you bank, because you're not going to get a 10% increase each year or whatever it would be, a $3 million increase every year. So some money has to be saved in some fashion, and that's to be discussed. And then there's a question of, do you want new services or new things? So do you want new programs in the schools? Do you want new programs in the, you know, for human elder services? All those things are on the table. But I will say, and I think I can speak for the schools on this one, the driving need for an override is to maintain level services. And if anything new comes into this, it's not going to be very large or very noticeable.
You present it.
Okay, so the question is right in the very back.
Thank you for the information. Linda Phillips, Wall Street, I'm a town meeting member. I wanted to ask, Bob, I think I sent an email to Sharon, the town accountant. How will paying all of our school building projects affect the overall overrides, right? So those building projects overrides are going to go away over a period of time?
The high school and very small parts of Wood End and Barrows renovations and the library were all done as debt exclusions. So those will go away. They will go away in 8 years. All of those will go away in 8 years. Well, hopefully not the buildings, the extra cost. So that's, I'd have to do a number in my head. Probably $400 a household, $500 a household of what households, average households are paying now will disappear. So your tax bills will go down in 8 years from now by that much if nothing else changes.
The library will still be on top of the right?
I'm sorry, would you ask again?
The library will still be paying for that, or is that a short-term debt?
We're also borrowing that only for 10 years, so we'll have 8 years left.
Certainly in your daily life, cost of living has increased. From groceries to everything, gas, gasoline,
I'll start with some of those. 29% is what school, town, and light department employees pay. Town pays 71%.
And how does that work?
Of those peer communities, the average is 24% for employees, 76% towns and schools. If you do nothing else but just look at that math, the employees are paying $1 million a year more for health insurance in Reading than in other towns. So again, I understand that we don't always want to compare against our peers, but that's one fact. In terms of the number of people taking health insurance, I don't have any idea off the top of my head, but I know we have those figures. In the last 3 years, with those unions, the town, school, and light department, we've negotiated a don't farm your farmland plan. In other words, if your spouse has coverage and you opt out of the town's plan, we'll give you money. Philosophically, I despise that. Financially, it's been a home run. We've saved $500,000 over the last 3 years. If everyone did it, we'd all lose. But for those spouses, again, that have other, you know, public or private jobs, and they choose to use that health insurance instead of the town's, the amount of money we pay is about 25% of what they would cost us otherwise, so we're saving the 75% of the savings. But honestly, I couldn't tell you as to what percent of our employees take health insurance. I just never really thought about it. In terms of the health insurance product that we have Blue Cross Blue Shield through a collaborative called Maya, which is about 100 communities in Massachusetts. 5 or 6 years ago, we took our first serious look at the state insurance plan, which is known as the GIC. Some of our neighbors have joined the GIC in the last few years, and now some of them are leaving the GIC. And each community has its own reason. I can't really comment, but I will say broadly that the appeal of the GIC was marketing and not financial for many communities. Communities went in and did somewhat amateur math and said, we're going to save $2 million. They saved $200,000. Well, it's still savings. The actual economic facts of the GIC did not look attractive to Reading. If the GIC performed as it had been, we could have saved $200,000 or $300,000 a year. That's not bad. We should take that. The GIC did not perform that way because the state legislature every year was subsidizing them. They were not running at cost neutral. You know, up to $100 million of taxpayers' money was going to pay health insurance for state employees, which I don't like at all. If that organization ever runs on a level playing field and we can really see the true economic costs of it, the unions and the management are absolutely interested in looking at it if it's viable. But we're really afraid that if the legislature suddenly backed away from that support, it would be more expensive than what we have. I think the rest of the questions were schools. Did you have any others you remember?
Well, it was kind of opinion just in following the budget that how they it's supposed to be level service, but when you compare the budgets, there's always more positions. They're always adding more, like they'll start off with a part-time position, and then it'll become a full-time position because they got a grant, and then after they have the grant, then they want to keep the grant goes away, but then they want to keep that position.
Let me just make one comment about level service, because this has been a discussion we've had for about 10 years. Let's say the population of Reading is 24,000, and we have 24 police officers, and it's now 25,000. What's level service? Is it 24 police officers, or is it 25? Many people would say 25. I've always said 24, but that's probably not the right answer. The right answer is not how much people you have or how much work you do. It's how much demand there is in the community to be leveled. So presumably, if you have 4% more population thinking of nothing else, you need 4% more public safety. So in that sense, different parts of the community grow, their needs grow, and level services grow, even if nothing else changed. And I'll let Dr. Doherty answer some of your others.
Thanks. You had made a comment that the budget's gone up $5 million since 2000, which is 17 years ago. So. Several things, a lot has changed in education in the last 17 years. We have technology, infrastructure, and technology needs, which are enhancing learning. Our special education costs, which is why we are trying to build more in-district programs. When students go out of district, It's very difficult for us to control the costs because the way that state laws are established and written in regulations, if a out-of-district placement shows hardship, they can raise the tuition whatever percent they want. So the more we can keep our students in district, the better, which is why our special education staffing in-house has gone up, because we're trying to keep more students in district, because it's a lot more expensive to put someone out private placement with tuition expenses. So we've tried real hard to do that. So technology, special education, and cost of living adjustments are also. But as I mentioned to you earlier, mentioned to the group earlier, Reading pays in the bottom half of our comparable communities. If we don't try to have a competitive salary, we are going to lose quality teachers, which will hurt the quality of the school district, and that's the bottom line. People are not going to stay around if they're making significantly less wages. We try to make the working conditions as best as we can. You know, we do things to do that, but the bottom line is that they can make a decent salary at a neighborhood school, at a neighboring town. They're gonna do it.
Just to follow up on one of the comments on special ed, that was one of the numbers that concerned me, because the number of kids going out of district is the same today as it was 17 years ago. The cost has probably increased, but we have had more in-house programs, and the number of IEPs have basically leveled. So I'm not sure what really explains the difference in the cost being so much more for the same number of students. Not like the town's gone from 23,000 to 24,000 at least. The school is virtually at a standstill for the number of students.
The percent of students that are special education have increased, and the severity of the needs have increased. We have more autistic children. And this is a national trend, this isn't just in Reading. We have more autistic children, we have children with more social emotional disabilities that require greater services. So that's really what's going on.
Thank you.
Linda, you also bring up words that none of us like to say, which is called unfunded mandates. Mm-hmm. In addition to state aid being challenging to get any money out of those guys, they often pass laws and rules that cost us money and they don't give us the money. So, you know, the simplest thing is they'll pass a new policy or a legislation or a rule and impose something on the town. It may cost the town $50,000, and we'll ask, well, we need $50,000 from you for this, and they just say, well, we'll see. So over the last 10 and 15 years in Massachusetts especially, the amount of unfunded mandates has soared. All of our departments, every single department faces those in one way or another. Something as simple as public records, public information, the public's right to know. That sounds like a really good idea. It sounds very democratic, and it is. It costs money to produce public records. We didn't get any money for it. It just is a new cost introduced slowly into the town and the schools, for instance.
Thank you. Questions?
Jeffrey Coyle, Ridge Road again. I want to comment a little bit on the how the salaries are below peer communities and sort of below what the market value, if you will, of these good teachers that are in Reading. I also want to notice that we've cut 3.4 FTEs from the high school. And I think originally that was that the high school was thinking maybe they would cut a Latin program. And a number of Latin parents came out and said, hey, parents and students came to the school committee and made a case for keeping that. So I'm guessing that would be, you know, back to those parents. And I think for the next year, if we don't see an override, I'm guessing Latin would be back on. But also now at the high school, we're seeing these cuts, as Dr. Doherty mentioned, are kind of spread out over all departments. And the other teachers lower kind of on average salary, but some of them are perhaps getting their hours cut to a 0.8. So instead of having a full-time job, they have 0.8 of a job because, well, they've cut out, eliminated a section of this, so they don't have anything to teach in that last block. So, you know, if I'm looking at, well, not only am I salary below average, but now I only have 0.8 of a salary, I think we're going to start to see a lot of these teachers leaving. I mean, I wouldn't blame any of them for leaving. And I think when we start to lose these teachers because maybe the budget isn't certain in the future it's going to be hard, if we want to postpone this a year or 2 years or whatever, that it would be very hard to rebuild after we lose some of these teachers. So I would say we need to make this override take care of some of these issues.
Right here?
Yeah, you mentioned earlier, Nate Chesley, New Street. You had mentioned earlier the idea that something like a rubbish collection fee could raise $1 million for presumably the monthly cost of a Netflix bill. I wonder what you guys think about other potential sources of revenue apart from residential taxes.
Do you have any suggestions? Because there's not a lot. Under state law, first of all, the town must only charge the cost of a service. So we might offer a service that costs us $50 a month. You might value it at $200 a month. We can only charge you $50, even though the supply and demand might suggest a higher price. So that's important to know. The town, at least, looks at its fees maybe every 3 to 5 years. And again, against our peer communities, generally speaking, the selectmen historically have been comfortable by being 5 to 10% below average, because they're viewing the fees as almost always paid by residents and it's a service to the community. So we're not trying to gouge people with fees. The only fee that really stands out as being a deal, and it depends whether you use it or not, whether you agree, is the $25 for the depot parking / compost center. If you park for a typical work year at the MBTA lot, right next to it, it's $880 a year. No one in Reading has to do that. Those are the non-Reading residents, and they deserve to pay that much. but otherwise, our fees line up with our peers pretty well. Again, understanding that it's offered as a service, and many of them are below average, but not a lot. But as an example, we did a study, what is now 3 years ago, on ambulance fees. You know, you think about it, you don't want to gouge people with that. They're not choosing to do it. But we were about 15 to 20% below average. So the selectmen chose to raise it to between 5 to 10% below average. We're now collecting $800,000 a year in ambulance fees. We were down in the 600,000 area, so it raised a lot of money. So it's not an insignificant amount, but again, there's a philosophical part of that equation. It's very hard to come up with new fees. I know the schools have had fees that when I was a kid, I could have never imagined paying to be a drama student or an athletic fee. You know, do we want to start having fees for you to come into town hall? Yeah, you couldn't afford it. you know, there's some things that we would certainly raise a lot of eyebrows if we introduced a fee that no one had ever done before. It has to reflect the cost of the service.
So the number has increased a little bit. We do average, over the last several years, we've averaged 25 to 30 teachers that leave for a variety of reasons. And not every person is leaving to go to a neighboring community to make a higher salary. What we're finding, this is a much more transient population, this generation of staff. We have a teacher that resigned for next year so that they can go teach environmental classes in Colorado. which is great. I wish it sounds like a great experience. So we do have teachers that leave for family reasons. They leave because they're relocating out of state. We do have teachers that are leaving to go to neighboring communities for higher wages and salaries and benefits. So it's a mix, but we have seen an uptick in the number of teachers leaving over the last few years.
And in general, employees in the public sector do not choose that work for money. Virtually all of them could earn more money in the private sector. But it is getting to the point where money is becoming a factor, so that's how significant it is. We have also seen turnover, but probably more in a more difficult way, we've seen the lack of ability to hire. So as we have normal attrition from retirement typically, we have had positions unfilled for 1 and 2 years because we have not been able to hire at the posted salary the quality of the employee we want. We could have accepted less of a quality. We're not usually willing to do that. And John's right, the next generation coming along, I better be careful how I say this, but if you've noticed the town hall, that next generation doesn't work there yet. As there is turnover, it's going to be very difficult for all municipal governments to retain the next generation of employees. They have different sets of values. They are more transient. We are seeing it in some of our departments already where overtime is not very interesting for some employees because they prefer to have time off. If you go back 20 years ago, people were fighting for overtime. So it is becoming more challenging to run a municipality in a lot of ways. And we're trying to adapt as best we can, but we know we're never going to, you know, money and wages are never going to be the attraction for this job. It just needs to be reasonable.
Yes,
Rachel. Ian Brown, Precinct 8. Can you go to the slide where it showed the cuts from the school? Because it's one thing when we talk about cutting the occasional teacher here or there, or cutting the supplies, but now you've actually cut a course out. Like, the freshman advisory program only exists for freshmen. It's not there for any of the other grades. So
you're generally right, with an exception to be how much trash you generate. So those that generate the most pay the most. But otherwise, you're right, it's a flat fee for a typical. If you have one barrel, it's a flat fee. Everyone pays the same.
Further questions?
Yes, Mayor.
I was wondering if you could comment on what the back view from 440 Melbourne Avenue. What does the town and the school pay for networking service infrastructure with the various providers? And has the town considered potentially putting that in house, managing their own private infrastructure, and selling the access to residents?
I'm not sure I heard your whole question. So you're asking about networking services and the cost of technology broadly, I guess?
Specifically what we're paying to outside providers to
Almost zero. We do. It's almost all homegrown.
It's all in-house.
We have software licenses that we pay, but all the infrastructure, the wide area network that connects all the towns, there was a capital cost to build things, but we have staff that does it all. We're a very kind of lean organization in that sense. We have vendors all the time coming to help us, and they walk away because they're going to cost more than how we do things. So it's pretty good. Our technology isn't the same as it would be in the private sector, but for certainly the cost, it's effective.
More questions? Are you missing anybody?
One final question, very brief. Sorry, I asked two questions. The dividend from Reading Municipal Light growth has fallen from 1.4% to 70 basis points or something, or 40 basis points even.
Can you speak up, please?
Yeah.
Just a question about the differential in dividend being paid from Reading Municipal from 1.7% to 0.4%. I'm curious what is responsible for that reduction.
Sure. Again, the question was the light department and what they pay us annually. That's set by an agreement, a very long-term agreement done, I don't know, 20 years ago or so. And there's 10-year renewals, so we're into it for another 10-plus years. There's a very specific mathematical formula that probably when it was set was a reasonable one to use. It's the Boston-Brockton-Nashua Consumer Price Index every year. So going back in the 80s, you know, that number was nice and robust. Now, as anyone who follows economics knows, the CPI is a very poor measure of inflation. It's very low. So the light department is, if you will, benefiting from that. So the growth is low. We're for forecasting for the next few years, probably using about 1.5%, because inflation is not high. Technology has driven down typical inflation costs. But nonetheless, that's the agreement we have. Can we reopen the agreement? There's three of our neighbors that aren't going to be too happy. Wilmington, Linfield, and North Reading are customers only. They are furious that $2.5 million of their money goes to this town. If you look around at other municipal-owned utilities, no one is close to this much. So in a way, it was a really good deal, relatively, but it is not necessarily kept up in any sense with the cost of doing business. But as I add to the light department any time, and I'm glad this is on TV, we can always sell them.
Sorry, question up to the back. Yes.
So, Matt again, Culver Street. You mentioned the 3 years. What would it take to get all that back in terms of a number for the override? So you said we've been costing 15, costing 16, expecting costing 17, and we know. So what is roughly the total cost of that, I guess?
I think, quite honestly, that's a detailed discussion that's going to happen this summer. There's no fast and easy answer to that. Quickest answer is for next year not to do further cuts is about $3 million based on our assumptions right now. To get back to where we were a few years ago is going to be more than that. To keep pace in the future is going to be more than that. So that gives you a really rough idea.
And can you knock that through what $3 million is in terms of the percentage number? In other words, $3 million in override from 2.5?
$3 million would be about a 5% override. A little higher. You're in the ballpark. It might be in the low 300s.
Okay, right here.
Nancy Mellis, Wellsburg Road. I have a question regarding all the construction projects in Reading. Have these construction projects been paid for, or how does that get implemented, or is that in the budget, or is that
years, probably going back to the founding of Reading, there's been a list of people who want their roads improved. In the last month, we've had to develop a new list of those who are sick of their roads being improved. That's the honest truth. It's case by case. A lot of the big projects you see are state funded. So West Street is paid for 90% by the state, 10% by Reading. We borrowed money long ago and we've almost repaid it. The work on Lowell Street, or whatever it's called on the other side of town, is also a state project. It does involve some costs for the town, because we have our engineering staff out there to supervise it, but if they hire police officers, they have to pay for that. So the bulk of the construction, the big construction you see, is not on our nickel. But there is a certain amount of money every year, $600,000, that the town spends on local roads. We do way more than most communities, and that's another issue with Reading. We're a cut-through community, so we have to. I want to charge tolls to non-residents. I'm told that's not legal. But at the intersection of 93 and 128, during rush hour, we are a huge cut-through community, and we see a lot of traffic that has no interest in being in Reading. We want to be there for as short as possible. That wears and tears our roads. So we have a much higher cost of maintaining roads than most communities. Now, communities near us are about the same. But that brings up a good point that I really didn't mention, that by policy, the Finance Committee has said you should spend 5% of your annual revenues on infrastructure, on capital. If you can't afford to do a big project in the year, you borrow the capital as debt. So capital and debt are 5%. In a sense, if that holds as a policy, if we can afford to keep that, it doesn't really matter what projects are going on because it's not taking more or less of the budget. Where the issue comes up and what happened 13 years ago was it's a lot easier to cut capital than to cut teachers and police officers. At its worst, when I was a FinCom member, this town spent $70,000 on capital one year. The FinCom debt and capital policy suggests $4 to $5 million. So that's one way to balance a budget is let's stop fixing all the roads, all the buildings, everything else. That works for about one year. And then you start paying for it. Because back in those years, regularly at April Town Meeting, we were adding $100,000 to $200,000 to the public works vehicle expense line item because our equipment was so old. So there's a lot of pieces to that. But most of the work you see, you're actually seeing in town is not Reading money. But there should always be a certain amount of projects going on in town to keep our infrastructure.
Yes,
I did. I'd like to piggyback on this question. You said 2.5% of 5%.
Could you tell us your name?
Oh, sorry, Mike Fusco, Rural Drive. Piggyback on this question, you said 2.5% would go up to 5%. That'd be 5% or would be 7.5%?
7.5%. So 2.5% is assumed.
5%.
Yeah, 2.5% is a given, if you will. And then an override would be on top of 2.5%.
Okay, there's another one. Yes. Right in the back row. Yes.
Hi, Joan Hawkins, 49er, the subject. The Birch Meadow project got stepped out. And so that money is $1 million that's going back into the budget. That was the town meeting.
I didn't take it, honestly. It's not in my pocket. That's what one resident said. Let's say in simple terms, we were planning on spending $120,000 a year on this project for 10 years. We were going to borrow the money next Tuesday. Instead of doing that, we will pay our sunk costs. So for FY17, the budget in place will be needed for just one year. We'll need about $120,000. Actually, it's closer to $100,000. But in the future years, there'll be $120,000 of capital not spent that we had planned on spending. Again, if that FinCom policy holds, different capital will be done worth $120,000 every year. But it does, in a way, give FinCom a little bit of leeway that if we really need to, we could reduce the amount of capital spending. And for the last 2 years, instead of 5%, they've agreed to go to 4.75% just because we're in this bind. And that's worth about $200,000 a year. So that's not an immediate windfall to the town, but it is worth, in years 2 through 10, $120,000 a year. And by the way, I expect the Recreation Committee at some point to bring the whole project back.
Yes.
Peter Brown, 4th Street. moved to Reading in 1985, so I've lived here not quite as long as Bill has.
Another hand over here somewhere?
Yes.
Is absolutely a very strong yes, but the question is how. Again, we don't have vacant land. A former member of the Economic Development Committee suggests we started buying up homes. We didn't have any sellers. If you don't have vacant land, that means you have to put to better use your existing commercial industrial land. And again, I did mention that we are working on that. The selectmen added a planner that will probably bear fruit in 3 years from now. So there are some areas of town where we definitely can improve. But again, like the landfill, that really helped the budget for 2 years only. Reading does not have the raw material to develop to do a long-term fix that's going to make us never have to come back to the voters. That's what Burlington has. You see Burlington at only 62% residential, and you drive around, they still have a lot of land that's not developed. And guess what? It probably is not going to be houses. So that's just the hand Reading is playing. We have a lot of school children. We have a lot of houses. We don't have a lot of businesses. And like all these towns on the left-hand side, we need to ask for money more often than communities that have the other set. A comment was made at the last meeting that 50 or 60 years ago, the Board of Selectmen back then should have had the wisdom to look ahead and stop building so many homes. You know, that may be clear now. It probably wasn't so clear 50 years ago.
Questions? Yes, in the back.
That just said, you know, what you just said about why is he approving, like, did you set know, we have, the schools are getting overpopulated, the roads, the getting into a whole different system, I know, but, you know, all our resources are being stretched thin, and we just keep building, not simple homes, but we keep building these apartment dwellings, you know? I just don't have the rationale. We have the opportunity now to plan ahead, and I don't see why we're not.
The question is, effectively, how much can the local government control development in town? So in the specific example cited, it's the 40B housing project down by the train station. The old Doucette storage certainly would, and now the gas station on the corner. The town has virtually no say in what's going on there because of state law, but more importantly, perhaps, a developer has bought private property and wants to put it to a use. That doesn't, by itself, involve the town. It does involve the town in terms of how much housing can go in there, but it doesn't, it's not a, you know, the underlying zoning is what it is. It's a residential neighborhood. As I mentioned, we had made some changes to zoning and planned some more over the last 2 years and going forward, probably for another year and a half, to get a better control over what Reading can control in land plan. The Senate last week passed a zoning change that I understand will not pass the House this year, but will in a year. And it pretty much reminds all towns and cities, by the way, you have zero control over land. We have control as the state. That's, I'm paraphrasing. The state is absolutely very insistent on housing and affordable housing. They're driving affordable housing. It's obviously a problem. Just look at all the house values in Reading and imagine someone trying to move in with, you know, a modest income. But the problem is, Reading doesn't decide, you know, I'll just pick kind of a couple of simple examples, how many nail salons and how many bagel stores there are. The market decides that. You decide that. We can't decide that. There has been a couple of instances where, for instance, the Linfield Lifestyle Mall was originally proposed in Reading at a much smaller scale, and Pulte Homes is now there. A different board of selectmen heard a lot of residents saying they didn't want that. Town meeting voted no. That was a choice, but by and large, Reading does not usually have those choices over land use. And there has been a lot of housing brought into the town. Even when the housing is not directly producing children living in it, if seniors in Reading move out of a single family house into a one or two bedroom apartment, I assume a family that has or will have children is buying their house. So all new housing somehow does add to the school system. But again, Reading's tools are limited in what we can do in this area. We're doing the best we can. We know it's an issue, though.
Okay, any more?
Ian Brown, Christian Dave. We've mentioned really a two-part question here. You mentioned road a couple of times and which one to be paid. I wanted to know, is the rotary, is that us or is that the city?
I think it was someone on some foreign substance that designed it. Have you seen the YouTube video, by the way? It's really good. I've only driven it four times and almost got an accident only once. I think that's pretty good. That was the state in their infinite wisdom, and I don't really fully understand it, but one of our office workers that lives in New Hampshire said she has a rotary just like it up in New Hampshire. I don't know what someone was thinking. Some percent of it is logical and some percent of it doesn't seem to be. But the way I look at it, I'm somewhat of a free market person, some may even say libertarian. That's the government telling you what to do. decision on what roads to pave is, as you can imagine, kind of an interesting one. First, we have to decide locally, are we going to do any water main work, do any sewer work? And then, horror of horrors, we have to ask Boston, National Grid, are they going to do any work? And normally they do it about 2 months after we pave a road. But we do our best to try to engage them early. So you're trying to, first of all, line up all your infrastructure. So for instance, Oak Street, which I hope no one here lives on that, because for the next year you're not going to have a road. Water, sewer, and the MWRA are all working in that area and compressing it to a very short time frame, and then the road will be paved. And then the gas company will come along in a couple months. But we do our best to try to coordinate all these as best we can. Absent any projects, and all projects are designed to be paved. Now it depends on the extent of the project as to whether the whole road is paved or just half the road or a section of the road is paved. Otherwise, every road in town has what's known as a pavement condition index, which is updated about every 3 years or so. We don't fix just the worst roads in town, because if you did that, you'd slowly decrease the quality of all your roads. We don't just increase or fix all the best roads in town. A lot more roads would be better, but the horrible ones you couldn't even drive on. So it's really an art to combine all these. It's not a mathematical formula, it's an art to combine some of the worst roads, some of the not so bad roads, and some of the average roads, and try to let the town actually be drivable. That's been a challenge in the last year, again, because of non-Reading projects that we didn't necessarily know were coming when they did. So, you know, the question of how to do roads is really very complicated, and all we do at this point is post 1 year in advance the roads we expect to do, and that's subject to weather and budgets.
Any more questions? Yes.
I'm Sherry Vandenacker. If we're looking at services we'd like around the schools, I'd love to see us think about the budget going from the Wednesday half day at the elementary level to full day, and maybe full day kindergarten. I think there are more and more working parents in town, and it's quite difficult. Plus, we want better outcomes for our kids. So, thanks for that conversation.
Further questions? All right, looks like we might reach the end. Any more comments on the panels? No, well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.